So what I want to do now is I want to talk about common forms of resonance. These are patterns that I've basically just discovered while teaching organic chemistry, and I want to share these with you guys, okay? So let's talk about basically three right now: movement of cations, anions, and then neutral heteroatoms, okay? So let's talk about cations first. So cations, the way that this works is that if you have a cation next to a double bond, so let's go ahead and put that next to a double bond, okay? What that gives us the ability to do is now to switch the place of those electrons, okay? Because what I have is an area of high density on one side, which is a double bond. Remember that a double bond not only has a sigma bond, but it also has a pi bond. Remember that pi bonds are extra electrons that are shared between two atoms. So that's something that I can actually move, okay? Then I have an area of low density, which is my positive charge, okay? So if I want to move this around, what do I do? Well, it turns out that this is one of the easier examples. If you have a positive charge and a double bond next to each other, you can actually kind of swing them open like a door hinge using one arrow. So what that means is I would start from the high density, my double bond, and I would move towards the positive charge. But I wouldn't make it just towards the positive, I would make it towards that bond. So what I'm going to get now is that now I get a double bond in the place where the positive used to be, and now my positive moves over here, okay? What that means is that now my positive is actually distributed from that red, from the left side over here on the red, and then over on the blue side, it's going to the right side as well, okay? So what I'm trying to say is that anytime you have a positive charge next to a double bond, it can be represented by both of these drawings. It's not just going to stay in one place. Automatically, just by laws of chemistry, it's going to wind up switching places at some point, okay? The real molecule is going to look like a average of both of these, or a combination of both of these. So that's why I talked about the fact that none of them is a true representation. The best representation is by hybridizing both of these, and I'm going to talk about what that is in a little bit, okay? Now let's look at anions. What if I had a negative charge next to that double bond, okay? Now I have to ask you guys, what do you think is going to be the region of the highest electron density? It turns out that the double bond has a lot, but now that we have a full negative charge, that's going to have even more electron density, because a full negative charge means that it just has a lone pair just hanging out, okay? So if we have a full negative charge, we're actually going to use two arrows. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take these electrons and push them into this bond, making a double bond, okay? But now we have an issue. If I make a double bond there, then let's look at this carbon right here. How many bonds did it already have? Well, it already had a double bond, that's two. It already had a bond to hydrogen, that's one. And then it already had a bond to carbon. So we had four bonds already. If I make another bond with that negative charge, how many bonds is that carbon gonna have? It's gonna have five. That would be really, really bad. That would be basically impossible. You can't have a carbon with five bonds. That would be super terrible. So this is in a situation where we're going to use a rule that's called make a bond, break a bond. So if I make a bond on this side, okay, in order to preserve the octet of the middle carbon, I must break a bond, okay? Because if I don't, then I'm going to give this carbon that I'm shading in green, I'm going to give it five bonds, and that just sucks. So if I make this bond, I have to break this bond, okay? And when I break that bond, what winds up happening is that now I get a negative charge over here. Okay? So as you can see, with a positive charge, I didn't have to actually break any bonds because I was never violating any octets. But in the movement of anions or negative charges, I do have to break a bond because I am going to violate an octet. So what's important to note here is that cations move with one arrow, and then anions move with two arrows. Not so bad, right? Okay? So just remember that positive charges, they can like swing like a door hinge, whereas with a negative charge, I'm gonna use make a bond, break a bond, because of the fact that I have to preserve that octet of the middle atom. All right? Then let's look at neutral heteroatoms, okay? This is the last situation, and what this would be is that, remember that I said we can move double bonds and we can move lone pairs. So imagine that I have a lone pair here. Well, let's say imagine that I have my two lone pairs there for that oxygen, because remember that oxygen has a bonding preference of two bonds and two lone pairs. All right, cool. And then imagine that the nitrogen has one lone pair, because remember that the nitrogen has a bonding preference of three bonds and one lone pair. Remember this? This is how it's going to satisfy its octet and how it's also going to satisfy its valence. All right? So now let me ask you guys a question. Is there any way that I can turn these lone pairs, one of these lone pairs, into a double bond and not break an octet? Okay? And it turns out, let's look at our options. Basically, the two options are this. Either I could move one of these green lone pairs down here and make a triple bond, or what I could do is I could move one of these red lone pairs here and make a double bond, okay? It turns out you guys might be thinking, well, Johnny, why would I only move in that direction? Why couldn't I move like this? Why wouldn't I move the electrons down and make a double bond there? Well, first of all, the reason is because double bonds and electrons are the things that usually switch places. So I would want to go in the direction that's going to go towards the double bond. I wouldn't want to go away from it. So I would not go in this direction because that's away from my double bond. But on top of that, check this out. I have a hydrogen here, right? If I move these electrons down into this area, I would make a double bond here, okay? And I'm sorry, I actually had more than one hydrogen. I had two. There's two hydrogens there, okay? Because that's a CH2. If I move these electrons in here and make a double bond, I'm going to break the octet down here. And there's going to be no fixing that. There's actually no bond that I can break because these are all single bonds. And you can't break single bonds in resonance theory, okay? So what that means is that I would wind up getting a double bond down here that would violate this octet and it would suck. That would not be a good resonance structure. So instead, I'm going to deal with the other two situations that I was talking about, which is that either the O jumps down and makes a triple bond, or the N lone pair jumps up and makes a double bond. So let's look at the O making a triple bond. If the O made a triple bond, like this, okay, let's look at this for a second. Don't draw it, just look at it. How many bonds would this carbon have? It would also have five, so we would break another octet by doing that. Is there any way that we could break a bond to make that carbon feel better? No, because it turns out that there's just single bonds on both sides. So there's nothing we could do, we would be stuck. So we're definitely not going to move this lone pair either. So now I have one last choice. The last choice is that I would move these electrons from the N up and make a double bond, okay? If I make a double bond here, how many bonds will that center carbon have? Still five. So it looks like I'm screwed. Like either way, I'm always making five bonds. But there's one difference with this one. If I go ahead and go up and make the double bond up towards that carbon, guess what I can do? I can break a bond. So this is a situation where I'm making a bond towards a double bond. The reason that a double bond is helpful is because double bonds I actually can break, whereas single bonds you're not allowed to break. But double bonds, notice that I have these electrons in this double bond that are free to move. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a bond, and then for the sake of preserving the octet of this carbon right here, I'm going to break a bond, and that would be right here. So what I would do is I would basically turn two electrons from that bond into a lone pair on the oxygen, and that's going to preserve the four bonds that I need for that carbon right there, because I'm making one, but I'm also breaking one, okay? So what that would look like after I draw the resonance structure is I would now have a double bond here, okay? I would have no electrons on the N because I just used those electrons to make the double bond. And then instead of having two lone pairs, now I'd have the two lone pairs from before. So let's go ahead and draw those, the green ones. But now I'm going to have one more lone pair. The last lone pair comes from the bond that I broke. Because basically what I did was I took two electrons from that double bond and I made them into a lone pair. Now all we have to do is count formal charges and we're done. So this oxygen, it wants to have six electrons, but it turns out that it has seven. Okay, because remember we're counting sticks and dots. So this would have a negative charge. The N wants to have five electrons total, but right now it just has four bonds, right? It has the double bond, it has the single bond there, and then it has the hydrogen. So that means that the nitrogen wants 5, but it only has 4, so it's going to have a positive charge. And that is our resonance structure. Okay? So what we've effectively done is we've taken these lone pairs and we've just distributed them around, and now we're showing another way that these electrons can exist in this molecule. But notice that we're never moving single bonds. Single bonds are a big no-no. Don't break those. And also, we're not rearranging the way that atoms are connected.